If I had a hammer, I'd hammer in the morning. I'd hammer in the evening. All over this land.
And Sasha, why don't you now say more and say who's going to be speaking?
Just a minute. I will introduce you. We already starting panel. I will introduce you some speakers, and we have now some changes in the program. I will present ideas of Professor Piharovich and Igor Panyuta, who could not come to Moscow. Then will be speaker Ludmila Bulavka. I will show her. She is right here. You can see her. Ludmila Bulavka, she is doctor of science, and she is a researcher in Institute of Culture in Russia, in Moscow. And then one more person from Ukraine will come in a few minutes. He's a little bit late, and he came just from the east of Ukraine, and he participated in many events, and his name is, 1 minute, Pavel Zotov. Also, we will tell you a few words based on the interview of militants from Donbass region. They participated in these events, and they are fighting now. They are on the barricades. Plus, small information from Jan Delchuk, who is one of the organizers of a bridge, everyday bridge between Moscow and Donetsk and Ukraine in general. He is working all day long and sometimes even night organizing our connections. So in a few minutes we'll start.
Do you want to start, Sasha?
We have
everybody there.
If you're ready, we can start. Maybe in 1 minute our Ukrainian friend is coming.
Okay. So, does anyone want to ask any questions? We have 1 minute, and they're getting themselves organized there. Yes?
Can you introduce yourself?
What?
Can you introduce yourself?
Oh, yes. I'm sorry. I was working with the Skype. So, I'm Karsten Struhl. I teach at John Jay College in the philosophy department and the interdisciplinary studies program, which is why we were able to facilitate this a bit easier than it might otherwise have done. I've been on one other panel before, and this panel I'm essentially facilitating. I don't have any, although I've been following events in both Russia and Ukraine for quite some time, I don't have any special expertise in it, but the four people on the panel who will present somewhat different perspectives do have quite an expertise. How did we get them? Okay, how does this happen? Because Alexander Buzgalin, who is a friend of mine, who I introduced before, who is professor of economics and part of a group at Moscow State University, I'll say it again maybe for people who just came in, and part of a social movement called Alternatives, which also has a social journal. And I'll just mention again for people who weren't here, he has published in both English and Russian and other languages over 300 books and articles. He's quite proficient. And he has been at the Left Forum in the past, but he was not able to make it this year for various reasons. And he asked me if it would be possible to facilitate a Skype meeting with him and four other people. And it looks like two of the people are going to be substitutes for the Ukraine because there were problems in their getting here. One of them was actually in the barricades. Some of you may know there is at least at the beginnings of what could be a civil war in Ukraine. So, Sasha, are you ready?
Yes, we are ready.
Okay. Now we go. And what will happen is each of you will speak, and then I will turn it over to the audience. And what I'll have to do is ask any audience member who wants to speak to come up here so Sasha can see you. And
turns it around.
And no, because I turn around, I can't see it. You can see him here. Okay, begin.
Great. So, first of all, thank you very much, colleagues, for the opportunity to be with you, to have this bridge with New York, with my friends in the Left Forum, and with colleagues, all people who want to know the truth, at least our opinion about the truth, interconnected with events in Ukraine, in Russia, in the West, because we have real contradictions between all our countries. I want to stress that the title of our panel, Multipolarity of Contradictions, is extremely important. We have really contradictions. This is not only geopolitical conflict between Russia and the West and Ukraine in between. This is much more complex problem of internal social economic contradictions, of contradictions between oligarchs and ordinary people. Contradictions between people who have different languages and cultural traditions, and so on and so forth. But first of all, I want to present some positions to Ukrainian colleagues who couldn't come. You know that now the border between Ukraine and Russia is nearly closed, and some of them simply sent their video, but it was impossible to make very quickly English subtitles for presentation in New York, and I will just present some ideas of these people. I start from a person who is much more similar with mainstream Western leaders we are. This is Igor Panyuta. He is one of the leading persons in Socialist Party of Ukraine. And this party supported elections of new president of Ukraine. They said it's better than nothing. And general position of Socialist Party is that now we have a struggle between two imperialist superpowers. One is big superpower, United States of America, and their satellites on one hand. Another small superpower is Russia. And all conflicts are just a problem of imperialistic contradictions between these two superpowers. Also, Igor Panyuta said that there is no left ideas among defenders of Donbas and Lugansk and all eastern regions of Ukraine, and really not too much criticized position of modern Ukrainian government or junta. You can find the word which you prefer. And this is more or less well-known position among, let's say, social democrats. Another person, Professor Vikharovich, I will try to show now with my simple computer his name, his face on big computer, big screen. I will ask my friends, maybe it will be possible to see. Yes, please.
Okay, so we're looking
at... So, if you can see, this is Vikharovich, and I will present some ideas of his paper. So now I'm coming back with my laptop, and we'll continue. 1 minute, please.
We see you in many different...
Yeah. So, Professor Vikharovich stressed that he wants to give real analysis, and he's professor of philosophy in Ukraine, in Kyiv. And his position is interconnected with analysis of history and modern situation of Ukrainian contradictions. He's also very important specialist in Ilenkov dialectic, and his analysis is really historical, dialectical, based on the contradictions. So, first of all, this crisis is a real crisis based on deep social economic contradictions. Firstly, Maidan started from the protest against corruption and the union of top bureaucracy, Yanukovych, president of Ukraine in that time, from one hand, and oligarchs from another side. And their unity was really tragedy for Ukraine, and people were very angry about this domination of and oligarchs. But then Yanukovych and his family, or so-called family, started to move the power and the money in their pockets, and big part of oligarchs started to fight against, well, not to fight, started to oppose to this policy of Yanukovych. And finally, they decided to support a real protest from below and support Maidan. And finally, to Maidan came a lot of different people, partly really enthusiastic about necessity to change the system of economic and social power, partly paid by oligarchs, partly people who came from the West, especially of Ukraine, with nationalistic and sometimes even fascist slogans. Also, Professor Pikharovich stressed that in Ukraine, in the center and west of Ukraine, only 2% maximum of population supports Bandera, right-wing politicians, pro-Bandera, pro-fascist politicians. Really, I can stress now, I don't agree with his position, but I now just translate position of Pikharovich and not my position. Finally, he said that we received after February 21st, something like a conflict between Russia and United States on the territory of the Ukraine. And he says that from the mid of February, Ukrainian leaders became puppets in the hands of the United States bosses. And I think this is very important thesis of Pikharovich, and we must remember about this. And finally, he says that United States government made all this plan in order to inspire basis for maybe even new world war, war between Russia and Germany, and this is one of the goals of United States government and United States bosses. So this is a few theses of long paper of Professor Pikharovich, and if you have interest in the websites of Alternative, you can find this information. Finally, I want also to stress a few words from Jan Lipchu. He is really a painter, but he is a fantastic person, communist, who is spending now more than 1 month permanently on the Skype, internet, and the radio connection with people who are fighting in the east of Ukraine, who are on the barricades, who are under the fire. And he made a fantastic job, and we have now chronic of all these events. So this person, Jan Lipchuk, stressed that so-called government of Ukraine, which is recognized by Europe, is really a puppet in the hands of the United States. And the behavior of this new Ukrainian government, I'm reading text, translating his text, this Ukrainian government is trying to do in Ukraine now the same as Gaddafi, from his point of view, made before. And if in this case of Gaddafi, United States and Europe fight against him, now they support Ukrainian puppets and Ukrainian attacks on part of their people, part of Ukrainian people. Also, he says that it's a real civil war, and the Ukrainian army, especially special formations of right sector, these nationalist forces, they are killing a lot of ordinary citizens, women, older, elder people. And that killing of this civil population, citizens of towns, villages, and cities, is a real crime, and this is main characteristic of the model of behavior of modern government of Ukraine. Also, he stressed that according to this chronic, the biggest part of ordinary soldiers of Ukrainian army has no intentions to have a military conflict with citizens of Donetsk, Lugansk, and other cities and towns. They do not want to shoot. But Ukrainian government forced them to do this, and when they opposed to this oppression, pressure of Ukrainian government, they can be killed or arrested. And this is practice when Ukrainian troops are killed by another Ukrainian troops or right sector representatives because they do not want, didn't want to attack citizens in the east of Ukraine. Also, he said that Ukrainian government now use very heavy weapons. I don't know how to translate it. It's 152 millimeters artillery. Maybe it's good enough for understanding. This is a really huge artillery, which is used only in when big army attack, I don't know, special region prepared for defense. But this artillery is used against the ordinary towns and citizens. And a lot of other examples, I do not have now all this, I do not have now opportunity to present all these ideas. So my personal ideas I will present a little later during our session. And now I want to move my computer and to give floor to Pavel Zotov. He came from the east of Ukraine, from Kharkov. He is one of the leaders of Baradba, left independent organization, maybe the most active left independent organization in Ukraine. And he will tell you a few words during our limits, maybe during 10 minutes. Okay, Pavel, you have now opportunity to tell a few words to our friends. My warmest greetings to all the comrades abroad, to those who are interested about our situation. Just to say shortly, the Left Socialist Union Baradba have fought against the right-wing nationalism and neo-Nazis long before the events in Kyiv and in Ukraine, so-called Maidan, have occurred. And while it started to happen, we also presented our point, because it was started all about, it was all about slogans of joining the European Union, which the Yanukovych government, the previous government of Ukraine, didn't want to do. First they wanted very much, they promoted that idea for years. We will join European Union, Economical Association, etc., etc., and then suddenly they stopped. Next day, this, what is called Maidan, have started. After, later, it became violent. And it went through several cases, but it is quite a long story about it. If you will want, we can one day present the development of this Maidan, etc. But what it ended, we basically can evaluate now, and we understand the situation from inside also. It ended with the victory of one oligarchic circle upon another oligarchic circle. Let's speak oligarchs, which were anti-Yanukovych, could win over those oligarchs who supported Yanukovych. And what we have now? We have in Ukraine the rule of plain oligarchs, which are the biggest capitalists of the country. Biggest holders of property, money, connections, everything which is which can be called, so to say, strong part of capitalism, whatever. So strongest capitalists.
Pavel, we just want to show you the audience who is listening to you, so you know they're there.
So, my word is good. So, after the, all of this happened, what did they use to win? They used the groups, and it was not actually very big in number. They were not very big in number, but they had enough of militant groups that called themselves neo-Nazis openly. First, it was organizations called Patriots of Ukraine, Ukrainian National Army, but it was not the name of organization. This name doesn't reflect that it has some connection with the actual army of Ukraine. And also there was an organization called the White Hammer. Those were from long ago absolutely openly neo-Nazis groups. They had Hitlerism, racism in their ideology. Not only this, but more, there is much more to tell about this. Also, they have a basis, which we may say like it was a social group of supporters for those neo-Nazis. It was quite a wide circle of football fans called ultras. That ultras football fans, which were which had such a tradition of aggression against first of all against minorities, especially those from south. Let's speak. They always like to beat somebody from Asian immigrants like this. By organizing and by power of money, to organize both militant and aggressive groups of neo-Nazis. The oligarchic circles of Ukraine put Win on the streets of Kyiv. They pressed and pressed and pressed on that government, which was actually also quite a criminal government itself. But what came against this Yanukovych government is absolutely criminal. It is that they have no possible attention to any of basic democratic and human values, so to say. To speak about this, we have million facts for right now behind us. The constant prohibitions for any of peaceful meetings, for instance, for opposition, if we can call ourselves opposition, because actually now it is even more than opposition, because it is now close to civil war. And there is, so to say, elements of civil war present. Prohibition of peaceful meetings, prohibition of freedom of speech. You just try to go to to streets of Kyiv and some others, even Dnipropetrovsk, which is center of the country. You just try to go there and speak about, let's say, socialism or something against the ultra-nationalism. Next moment, their patrol will catch you. And there are videos about this. Thousands of those videos. Thousands of people, they beat for only expressing the opposition, so to say, opinion. And prohibitions of the peaceful meetings, prohibitions of freedom of speech, and etc. Those are absolutely anti-democratic, even anti-basic democratic, whatever, bourgeois rule. It is not even a democratic bourgeois government, as we can see, let's speak, I don't know, in Europe. It is absolutely against democracy, what they do, and it is also against humanity, because, this is another point, they always lie. This is the point. Whatever you hear from Ukrainian official, or not even official, but from Ukrainian oligarchic media, because all the media in Ukraine belong to some one of another oligarchic group. The most powerful of them is what is called Privat Group, led by the biggest sponsor of this coup, named Kolomoisky. Privat Group, Privat Bank, those are oligarchic group which was in the sharpest conflict with the Yanukovych oligarchic group. But those people hold the media. Whatever they say is lie and lie and lie. For instance, take the Odessa fire, which was a event, then they burned people inside of a building in Odessa. Yes, those people were combating with them. But they didn't try to seize, so to say, surround this building and hold somebody there like this. They start to burn them. The Ukrainian official media say those people have burned it themselves. By somehow, it doesn't matter. They just burned it themselves, all of these 270 people who died in the fire in Odessa. The Socialist Union Boryba combated with this sharply from the very beginning. First, we used every democratic method to do it. Meetings, rallies, speeches in whatever possible places, in internet, etc. We issued also almost every day our communique. But at the next stage of this, it lasted from the very beginning, from 21st of February, we claimed that we start the sharp anti-fascist, anti-Nazis movement, and we had these activities in many cities of Ukraine, and even now in the conditions of underground, really, because we had to go underground. We had losses. We had our people arrested. Actually, one of our greater comrades, so to say, the person which I personally very close to is Denis Levin. He is a Jew in his ethnicity. He was attacked by those Nazis, not only as a communist, but also as a Jew. And he was attacked and tried to, they tried to catch him several times. Now he is hiding underground. He cannot even make a call. But we know about where he is safe and well. But this is the condition we have now. We are underground in those places which are what we can say occupied by Nazi militants. And they remember one thing, first and very important. This Nazi coup serves to the only Ukrainian oligarchic circles which paid for much. And yes, they could really had some support by ordinary people because they hold all the media, and now they promote absolute dictatorship by absolute dictatorship of their Nazi circles in the Ukraine. Ukraine becomes a Nazi and fascist state in Europe in the 21st century. And communists fight against this. And Union Boryba now proclaims we turn to be a fighting communist party. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. It's really very important. And I want to say that our speaker came from the region where he could be killed any minute. So it's not only abstract words, this is practice, this is the reality of the struggle and life under the threat to be killed, arrested, beaten and so on. So I'm very glad that he is here alive, because a lot of his comrades are wounded, arrested and simply cannot talk openly with you and with anybody. And now I want to give floor to Lyudmila Bulak, she's a researcher of culture in Institute of Culture in Moscow, but she is also very active in contacts with Donetsk people, and he will present you not only her personal opinion, but also opinion of leaders of Donbass defense, real militants, real officers and soldiers who are fighting. And she had interview as a representative of Alternative Journal with them, and I'll work now as interpreter. You're welcome.
First of all, I'm very, very glad to participate in this very important forum. I see my many friends of America. Я далее буду говорить на русском языке.
So, Людмила will continue in Russian.
Я сейчас назову, транслирую основные принципы, ответы, которые дал один из руководителей Донецкой Народной Республики в интервью нашему товарищу Яну Левичу. Это второй курбет.
So, Людмила will now give some examples of opinion of leaders of Donbass region. And this is from interview which was made by alternatives with Ян Левчук, Людмила and leaders in Donetsk.
Первый вопрос был, поддержат ли граждане Донецкой Народной Республики самих антифашистов? Или это все-таки пассивная масса? Здесь говорят, что в Донецкой Республике бандиты, которые бьются с фашистами, но население не поддерживает.
So, first question which we ask, if really ordinary people, citizens, support these militants who are fighting against fascists, or they are just passive and only a few soldiers, a few officers are in this battle, involved in this battle. Is it so or not?
Поддержка гражданского населения есть, более того, она все время растет и растет.
And Людмила and Jan received a lot of evidences that there is direct civil support, support of civil society, ordinary people from below, and this support is growing from day to day.
Раньше приходили, еще в марте, в апреле, приходили на митинги, просто слушали. Сегодня люди идут на блокпосты, за баррикады, чтобы помочь реальным делам.
If in March or in April, people were simply coming to the rallies, demonstrations, meetings, to listen maybe to support or not support, but it was passive support. Now people are coming to the barricades, to the places where they can be killed. And they're bringing food, they're helping to with the medicine assistance. They're simply supporting by their words people and sometimes even stop aggression of opponents from Kyiv.
Они приносят покрышки, грузят мешки с песком, приносят еду. Шахтеры после тяжелой смены идут сразу и идут на баррикады, на блокпосты. Идут туда женщины, которые готовят еду, которые приносят медицинские средства и даже помогают подросткам и детям.
So it's not only men, but also women coming, but miners, first of all, workers from miners enterprises, they're coming after hard work to help to organize barricades, to build barricades, and they're working in other hours, and this is very sunny and very hot weather now, without any money, by the way, no money at all. This is pure voluntary activity. Women are coming to help with drugs, with food, with just good words to tell a few words, drugs, medicine, of course. Just tell it good words. Even young boys and girls, teenagers are coming, but everybody is trying to prevent their appearance on the barricades, of course.
Если до этого позиция проявляла слоги, то сегодня позиция проявляется делом.
If before position was expressed by words, now position of person must be expressed by real activity.
Сегодня второй момент. Все идет на основе энтузиазма. И борьба, и поддержка антифашистов.
Very important. All this struggle, both of militants who are on the barricades and those who are coming to help to this anti-fascist war, all this activity is voluntary activity, based on the enthusiasm, no money.
И это делается на основе самоуправления. Например, создан добровольный медицинский отряд в Донецкой Народной Республике, где где врачи, в частности, руководитель этого добровольческого медицинского отряда, который делал диссертацию, все забросил, сейчас занимается медицинской помощью.
So, and the model of organization of this activity is self-organization from below, with elements of self-management, but in very simple but working forms. People are coming together, different people, including, for example, very good professional doctors and leader of the voluntary medical group, if I can say so. This is a big group of militants for doctors, nurses and so on, they organize themselves without any initiative from above, without any money, and they came to help to people, citizens, soldiers, defenders. And the leader is a good scholar, and he stopped all his scholar activity, his work. He doesn't have money now because he left the job, and they're working for nothing, just to help people.
Следующий вопрос. Кто вам помогает? Где вы берете средства? Ответ. Евгения, вот руководителя этого антитеррористического отряда, ответ был таков. Это добровольные пожертвования частных лиц из Израиля, из Германии, от американских лиц, товарищи.
Very important question. What are the source of the money which you have? Because of course they have some money. And Yevgeny, this is direct quotation, he is leader of the anti-terrorist group, group of militants who are fighting against terrorist actions inside east of Ukraine. And there is big threat and there are a lot of such actions in the east of Ukraine. And he said, we do not have any support of oligarchs or big business. We have money only from ordinary people, and this is small money which are coming from different regions and countries. Israel and United States, Europe, I can add Russia, Ludmila did mention, but he said about Russia too, from different regions of Ukraine. This is small money. And when our group Alternative, this is from me, this is not quotation from Evgeny, when Alternative sent money, it was small money, it was $20, $50, $100 from different personalities, it was not oligarch money.
Следующий вопрос отношение к собственности. Олигархи испугались, что Донецкая Народная Республика провозгласила конфискацию олигархической собственности.
And the question is also, what is your relation towards the property? And in Donetsk Republic, there is initiative to expropriate property of oligarchs, which is not used for production. And this is anti-oligarch intention.
Ответ Донецкой Народной Республики таков. Мы не трогаем личную собственность, машины, квартиры, огороды, ни в коем случае. Личной собственности нет. Но та собственность, которая была... появилась в результате криминальных операций, эта собственность должна принадлежать обществу. И прежде всего самым слабым из них, детям, инвалидам, пенсионерам, ветеранам войны.
So this Евгений said in his interview that we will never take anything from personal property, cars, apartments, houses, gardens, land of ordinary people. But when we are speaking about property of oligarchs, criminals who are fighting against us, who supported killing of our people, we will use this property for the support of kids, for the support of elder people, for social needs.
Следующий вопрос. На каких принципах вы собираетесь строить систему управления своей Донецкой Республики?
The next question. What are the principles which we will use for the creation of new state in Donetsk region in the east of Ukraine?
Ответ очень был четкий. На основе открытой демократии, открытости информации, финансовой открытости, демократия – это главные принципы нашей Народной Республики.
And he said, by the way, this is leader of a militant group of military people. And he said, we want to use principles of democracy, and the most important is transparency. Transparency of all financial floatings, of all money floatings, transparency of decision making. And we will talk with ordinary people and make our steps together with them. Open democracy. This is direct translation from Russian.
Деятельность всех чиновников должна быть открытой. И если она не будет отвечать интересам общества, то эти чиновники будут меняться с такой же частотой, с какой они появлялись.
And also his idea was that we want to have transparency of activity of bureaucrats. And they must be changed if they do not want to follow to the interests of people. And we will change them. And we already changed some of them if they did not follow to our interests.
Вопрос следующий. Какие у вас социальные программы? Вот на какие социальные программы ориентирована Донецкая Народная Республика? Ответ следующий.
Do you have any social programs, social goals in Donetsk Republic? Do you discuss this question? It was another question of alternatives.
Для нас прежде всего это интересы общества. Это уменьшение пенсионного возраста. Это субсидии, сохранение всех субсидий инвалидам, ветеранам войны, детям в детских домах.
So they said that we want to support social needs of ordinary people. Urgent task is to support houses where, I don't know, hotels where kids are living, kids without parents are living. Then support elder people and we will not increase pension ages, we will decrease age when person can have pension. I'm sorry, I'm a little bit nervous because of the important topic. And other goals, social goals.
На Украине сейчас, по всей Украине, растут тарифы на коммунальные услуги. Позиция Донецкой Республики. Мы сохраняем старые тарифы и ни в коем случае их не будем увеличивать, будем даже уменьшать.
The same with tariffs for gas, electricity, housing and so on. Ukraine, center, west of Ukraine, has very rapid growth of these tariffs. and 100%. And Donetsk region people said that we will use all possible and impossible measures not to have this increase of tariffs.
Следующий, да, и обязательно самая большая проблема – это сохранение заработной платы не только для тех, кто работает, но и для тех, кто воюет, чтобы семьи не страдали. Но это самая большая проблема для Донецкой Республики сегодня.
And the main problem, he said, that people, especially men who came to the barricades to protect citizens who are now fighting with armament in their hands, they do not have wage because Donetsk region had the same capitalism as all other Ukraine in the past. And they are trying now to implement special law to pay just wage which people had before if they are defending Donetsk Republic as soldiers, as officers.
После этого был, конечно, вопрос. Вы что хотите сделать СССР номер два? Нет, сказали они. Советскую историю повторить нельзя, но взять то лучшее, что у них было, мы должны. Не только у Советского Союза, но и всей мировой практики.
And it was another question, which is not alternative question, but which we have from all mass media. Do we want to build new Soviet Union, USSR second? And Yevgeny said, no, we understand that it's impossible to build again Soviet Union, and it had a lot of negative features, but we want to use positive experience of Soviet Union, and we will do this if we will be alive.
Так и вот был главный тоже вопрос, который завершал это интервью. Какие главные причины противостояния? Почему вы стали воевать с бандеровцами?
So, and the final question was, what are the reasons of the conflict? Why are you fighting? Why you decided to use, to take guns in your hands to oppose these pro-fascist attacks?
Это война, вот все, что происходит сегодня на Украине, на юго-востоке, это не национальный конфликт, не межнациональный, это социальный конфликт, политико-экономический.
It was said that this conflict is not conflict between two nations or people with different languages. This is not inter-nation conflict between nations. This is conflict based on the social and political contradictions.
У фашизма, потому что у фашизма нет национальности. Фашизм есть фашизм.
And he said that this is struggle against fascism, and fascism doesn't have nationality. This is struggle against killing of people, I can add.
Поэтому мы все в Донецке действительно являемся антифашистами.
And from this point of view, we are defenders of our country and we are anti-fascists.
А конкретные причины первые, сказали представители Донецкой Республики. Деньги, которые зарабатывают регионы, идут не в регионы, а идут в центр киевской хунты.
There are also some simple and visible economic and social reasons, because Donetsk region produced a lot of income, or was producing in the past a lot of income, and this income was transferred to the center, to the junta, to bureaucrats, to oligarchs in Kyiv, not for the people of Ukraine, not for the people of the east of Ukraine. And this is important economic reason for conflict.
Второе, газ на Украине принадлежит всему украинскому народу Украины. Но сегодня это частная собственность олигархов, и мы вынуждены платить за это высокие цены не только на юго-востоке, но и на западе Украины.
And also there is a problem of the price for the gas, which is an important part of expenditures of ordinary people. And very big prices on the gas are interconnected with policy of Ukrainian oligarchs and with their attempts to appropriate gas rent, if I can say so.
Третий момент. Бандеровцы считают, что труд – это удел рабов. И человек труда, те же шахтеры, должны сидеть в шахтах и отдавать свой труд националистической элите.
Then people who are taking us, and by the way, some of them has Bandera, this Ukrainian fascist, as the hero, they do not respect working people, the labor. They think that this is just for primitive people, and for us this is opposite. We are working people, and we want to respect labor.
И вот четвертая причина. в этой войне, в этом антифашистской войне мы не уничтожаем, не сжигаем даже пленных, мы их кормим, пытаемся вернуть матерям, работаем с родителями, в отличие от бандеровцев, которые уничтожают, сжигают людей.
And fourth reason, we are not aggressive, but we must protect ourselves. And examples, even when we have former soldiers of Ukrainian army arrested, we never kill them. We give them food, we give them medicine assistance, and mainly we liberate them after that. We have a lot of mothers and fathers of the soldiers who are coming to us and ask to liberate their sons, and of course we do this. And from my point of view, I can add that we have a lot of videos which shows that this is a real fact. This is not only their words.
И последняя причина – евроинтеграция уничтожает культуры региональные, культуры татар, украинцев, русских, евреев. Эти культуры должны быть сохранены.
And finally, the cultural reason, because they don't want to have globalization and negation of national cultures, and they do not want to have McDonaldization. I want to translate Russian words. To protect development of national cultures of Ukrainian people, of Russian people, Jews, Tatar people, and so on. By the way, I participated also in this interview, and I can add that this Yevgeny said, my favorite songs are Ukrainian songs. And in our group, there are a lot of Ukrainians, and even people from the west of Ukraine. This is not only Russian people. Russian language speaking people, not Russian nationality.
И в завершении я уже от себя назову коротко очень три основных противоречия Донецкой Народной Республики.
And three main contradictions which are typical for Donetsk Republic, because this is also very contradictory of course situation.
Первое противоречие. Реально Донецкая Народная Республика борется против фашизма.
Donetsk Republic is fighting against pro-fascist tendencies, attacks, groups.
Из-за этого погибают молодые люди, мужчины, женщины.
And men and women are dying because of that.
Но лозунги этой борьбы пока имеют национальное выражение. Славянское единство, хотя там воюют и украинцы, в руководстве Донецкой Республики украинцы, русские, евреи, башкиры.
But slogans and ideas of leaders of Donetsk Republic are very often interconnected with Russian nationalism or Russian statism. There is such word in Russian, держава, power, big power. And this is one of the contradictions. These Russian laws are existing in spite of the fact that among defenders are peoples of different nationalities.
Второе противоречие. С одной стороны, Донецкая Народная Республика пытается строить демократическую модель открытой социально ориентированной системы, но лозунги пока сохраняются державные.
Second contradiction. In reality, the organization of Donetsk Republic is democratic and with many features of grassroots democracy. But the formal slogans and model are interconnected with statist rhetoric and respect to the strong hand power.
Иногда поступки в истории, иногда поступки людей отстают от их идей. Здесь мы видим наоборот. Сознание людей отстает, не поспевает за их поступками. Поступки опережают их взгляды.
There are a lot of examples in the history when the activity is behind the words. Beautiful words and not beautiful old-style activity. In Donetsk Republic situation is opposite. This is new progressive actions, activity and old, sometimes regressive archaic slogans and mentality.
И последнее противоречие между той войной, антифашистской борьбой, которую ведет Донецкая Народная Республика, и ориентация на будущее новыми альтернативными программами, ради которых все это идет.
And also there is contradiction between tactic goals and necessities to fight against these attacks, just to defend, to prevent mass killing. And from another hand, there are some interesting intentions, strategic intentions of new alternatives of the future.
И последнее совсем, этическое, критерием этической правды Донецкой Народной Республики, как наподобие Парижской коммуны, наподобие испанцев, которые воевали в гражданской войне в Испании, является то, что сегодня мир поднялись левы всех стран мира. Вот это один из главных критериев этической правды. Если бы здесь шел только передел собственности, мы бы с вами сейчас не проводили бы этот круглый стол. Но он есть. Это доказательство их правоты. Против борьбы, против национал-либерализма.
So, the people said that this is not, of course, simply a contradiction between different imperialistic intentions. This is a much more complex struggle for new forms of social life, in some respects similar with Paris Commune or civil war against fascism in Spain, where also participated very different forces. And here we have something like a struggle against national liberalism, national liberalism, I don't know how to translate, it's parallel with national socialism, the name of the fascists in Germany during Hitler. And the international solidarity, anti-NATO actions in many towns and cities of Europe and different countries of the world, this is example of, not example, this is proof that struggle in Donbass is not simply a struggle of pro-Russian forces against pro-US forces.
И только сейчас, закончив свое выступление, я поняла свою большую ошибку, которую я сделала. Меня Евгений просил передать от имени Донецкой Народной Республики пламенный привет солидарности с форумом левых сил Америки.
And finally, Людмила wants to translate words of Евгений, with whom he had talked just before this Skype air, and Евгений asked to transfer greetings and expression of solidarity, of international solidarity with participants of the Left Forum. Thank you.
Спасибо, thank you very much.
Before you continue, Sasha, before you continue.
Yes, I want to continue, and how much minutes I have.
That's what I was about to say. I think we should leave a good half hour for questions, because I think many people here will have questions.
Okay,
and that will leave you about 25 minutes to continue, and then we'll have the questions. I also just wanted to say for people, Ludmila Bulavka was not introduced. She's a leading researcher, that's who you just saw, at the Institute of Culture in Moscow, and also part of the editorial board of Alternatives. And she, her main areas of research are Soviet and post-Soviet culture and contradictions of self-organization. We're now going to have a little more discussion, because this is a panel, and after that, we will open it up to the audience. So we'll have about 25 minutes to a half hour. Do you want to say something first?
Who is Yevgeny? What is his position?
Who is
the person who is quoted, who is interviewed?
Katan, I didn't understand. Will you give me 10 minutes to talk? Or
can you hold that question till he talks? Because we'll get people up, and I'll ask that. But he was asking, who is the...
Yevgeny.
Who was the interview with? That's right. He was asking just who was the interview with.
The person could not tell the family name.
Okay.
He said just that he is Yevgeny, and he is one of the leaders of the anti-terrorist organization. They are protecting people from terrorist actions inside east of Ukraine, Donetsk and other regions.
So, we'll continue now with your talk, and then we'll have about a half hour for questions, and what we're going to do is have people come up here. I'll call on you, and you can form a line, and you can each ask questions, and then he'll respond. Okay, continue, Sasha.
Thank you, Carsten. Now, a few minutes for my presentation also.
So I want to summarize some ideas which we can conclude from presentations which you heard and from the many hour discussions with people from the east of Ukraine, from the center of Ukraine, with different specialists in Moscow. We had many seminars, rallies, discussions, and of course situation is not simple at all. First of all, I want to stress that Ukrainian authorities are not really democratic, and you had a lot of opportunities to understand this. Of course, it was elections, but a big part of Ukraine didn't participate in these elections, and we had a lot of evidences of falsifications of elections of the president. Plus, it was really impossible to express any form of real opposition to opinion, to ideas of modern Ukrainian leaders. All people who wanted to say something against them could be beaten and arrested, and some candidates to be president were arrested and beaten in Ukraine. And the conflict and tragedy in Odessa, you know, was one of the expressions of such a real threat. So first, I think this is anti-democratic power. Second, the economic and social intentions are right-wing liberal intentions. The fact that oligarch is leader of Ukraine now is only one of such examples. But also there are a lot of other facts. The governors for Ukrainian eastern regions of Ukraine from Kyiv were also oligarchs, and they could not take power in the east of Ukraine, but they attempted to do this, and the candidates were pure oligarchs, owners of billions of dollars. The more important economic policy, which is realizing now in Ukraine, in the center and west of Ukraine, is very similar with policy of shock therapy or shock valve therapy in Russia and in Ukraine in early 90s, in 1990s. And now International Monetary Fund is also giving different loans, but the basis for these loans is realization of the policy of shock therapy. Third, really Ukrainian government now, Kyiv government, realized very aggressive and based on the open force, non-legitimate force policy. Attacks in the east is only one part of this, but a lot of people who are beaten and killed in the center of Ukraine, in Odessa, in the west of Ukraine by Nazis, by right-wing forces, this is also part of this policy. What is also important is the fact that modern Ukrainian Kyiv government is in the hands of the United States and sponsored by the United States and partly by the European Union and partly by NATO, or better to say countries, members of NATO. So, of course, there is important to stress that prehistory of this government was not so simple. As I said in the introduction, people who came to Maidan half a year ago had the democratic intentions, anti-oligarch intentions. And part of them, by the way, now again came to Maidan. See, today, I don't know if you heard this information, thousands of people came to Maidan to say, we do not want to have oligarchs as our leaders. And this is new event, by the way, event in the center of Kyiv, not only in the east. If we move to the east, as you, Ludmila, said, it's a really contradictory situation. Of course, uprising in the east of Ukraine is not pure democratic socialist, or at least social revolution of ordinary people. It's not 100% the same as Paris Commune or something like this. Of course, behind we have Russia, and Russia is a small imperialistic country, not superpower, not empire, but periphery, small empire, maybe something like that. And all our leaders and oligarchs are not angels at all. They are the same persons as the Ukrainian oligarchs. All this is true, and this is one part of contradiction. But there is another part of contradictions. This is the real intention of people to defend themselves. to defend their homes, to defend their values, to defend their lives, to defend their language. And this is a real uprising from below. So we have deep contradiction inside this struggle in the east of Ukraine. Contradiction between, from one hand, statist, sometimes even nationalist, pro-Russian intentions, and of course, influence of Russia with all negative features of Russian capitalism. But from another side, real struggle of the people against those who want to kill them, occupy them. And among ordinary Russians, there is fantastic support of Ukrainian struggle. We never had this type of enthusiasm of millions of people, nearly 90% of population now will say, we support these people. I have my friends, 60 years old professors, who are seriously asking me how they can go to the east of Ukraine and to take gun in the hands and to protect people. And this is not hysteria, this is hysteria, this is not nationalistic hysteria. This is attempt to create a new type of life. And if we can have now Ukraine, unified Ukraine, where all people in the east, in the center, in the south, in the west will be together, and this country will be outside of any blocks, will not be satellite of Russia, will not be satellite of NATO. Real independent democratic country where everybody can use the language which they want, Russian language, Ukrainian language, Tatar language, doesn't matter. If such intention will be now in Ukraine, I am 100% sure that absolute majority of Russians will support this intention, and majority of Donetsk Republic will support this intention. They're fighting not against Ukrainians, they're fighting against nationalist, semi-fascist forces, pro-oligarch forces. Of course, the struggle is also partly based on the interests of the oligarchs from the east, and this is also true. As I said, this is not pure socialist revolution, pure uprising of ordinary people. But there are elements of such uprising. There are elements of real enthusiasm, voluntary work and voluntary struggles, and real heroism of ordinary people. That's why it is important to take into the consideration. And a few words about Russian nationalism, statism, and so on. Yevgeny, with whom we had interview, said directly that he is supporter of Russian Empire. This is true. I don't want to make any idealization of these people and of him personally. But from another point of view, he said, as I mentioned, we want to have Ukraine for Ukrainians, Russians, for everybody. We want to have two languages in our region, Ukrainian and Russian language. We want to have transparent government. We want to have big social programs for ordinary people. We do not want to have authoritarian leaders. This is one of the paradoxes. Support of Russian Empire is absolutely against authoritarian model of political organization in Donetsk Republic. And this is the reality. And we do not want to make idealization. And final remark, for us it's very important to have international solidarity with progressive tendencies in the east of Ukraine, in the center, in the west of Ukraine. Real struggle against military actions, against mass killing of the people. And if we can have such support of a peaceful solution, if we can have this pressure on government in the United States, pressure on government in Ukraine, in all countries, in Russia, to stop a war, this can be extremely important for all of us. But now, if you will ask whom I support, of course, a big part of left people in Russia will say, both are worse. Russian imperialism is bad, United States imperialism is bad, everybody is bad, and we are for world revolution. Don't. I don't want to repeat this. I'm supporter of socialist future, I'm supporter of democracy, but in modern situation, I think these are all contradictions. Eastern people, people in the east of Ukraine, has more basis, has more necessity to support them than Kiev junta, Kiev government. This is my opinion. Thank you.
I'm going to take I'm going to take about...
He also made a call and said that he cannot participate in the interview today because he is under the attack. He is under the fire.
He's actually under
the fire. Because radio that he is shooting and cannot participate in scientific conference.
And that is who?
Yevgeny.
Okay. We're going to take several questions, but I'm going to take the... let me call on several people.
Can I just first question?
We're going to have...
Go ahead.
You can be the first question. As a tech support person.
As a tech support person, Sasha, здравствуйте. Hi, Людмила, здравствуйте. My first, absolutely first question. How you manage to speak for an 1 hour and never mention Crimea? Okay, and you don't need even to answer that question. Take several questions together.
Yes, we're going to get other people, and they're you're going to come up. Can we? Okay.
I will hold it. And
okay. One, okay. Two, three. If the three of you will come up, and then we'll get some more. While they're coming up, I want
you don't need to be too close to it. It takes. You can stay there, and I will. Yeah. Okay. I watch that you're visible. Okay.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, I was in the USSR, I was in Russia for 10 years in the 90s, fighting against counter-revolution, and including amongst the miners in Donetsk. What happened, the horror of Odessa, is just one example out of millions that have been the result of capitalist counter-revolution. It was the destruction of the Soviet Union and the return of private property that has been the motor force for the horrors we see. I was in Donetsk in 1993 when the coal miners showed their power as the working class and they shook Ukraine. Our message to them was that they needed to strip the face, the lie of democracy from the Yeltsin-Bush counter-revolution that had taken power on the barricades. The International Communist League, Интернациональная коммунистическая лига, четвертая интернациональная лига спартаковцев, ours was the very first published protest against Yeltsin. We called upon the Soviet working class to sweep away those elements who became, who come to power
can
as
I
the
ask
oligarchy.
Can I ask that you come to close because there are other comrades who
I'll
really
be very concise, thank you.
You've already gone up for 4 minutes.
Excuse me. Today, our program is for socialist revolution to sweep out all the oligarch regimes, but we take the stand of defending the right of Crimean Russia to be part of the Russian Federation and for the right of the people of the Donetsk Republic in the southeast Ukraine to determine their own fate. That is an essential part of our program.
Okay, I'm really
at the same time,
people, but thank you.
I want to let you know that we do not have any.
We really need to get people together. Thank you for your comments.
Please, okay. You can ask more questions.
Peace.
Can we Workers' Vanguard and the Spartacists League.
Okay, very good. Can we please have other people because it's really.
Yeah, actually, I have a question.
Yes, we want questions and we want people, and we're going to really ask people to keep your comments or questions to 2 minutes. I'm going to time it.
Okay. Yeah. There wasn't too much discussion of it in here, but of course we know that United States interference and subversion played a huge part in the overthrow of the Yanukovych government. There was a second Munich conference actually. But given the fact that the United States original program, what we might call the Newland. Yeah, the Newland program seems to have failed already. That the people's response in the East has been so powerful. But given the fact that the initial U.S. intentions have failed, how much of a danger is there of an expanded direct military intervention in the situation?
Okay, and there's one more question, and I'm just going to take a second while you're coming to ask my question, which is, it seemed to me that at the very beginning in Maidan, there were some genuinely progressive democratic forces involved in the first Maidan occupation. And I want to know if you agree with that first, and if you do, whether or not you think, whether what has actually happened to those forces at this point. Okay, let's get the next.
My name is Jan Norden. I'm from the Internationalist Group and the League for the Fourth International. I want to say that it's very interesting and very important to hear this report directly from Ukraine. Secondly, that there are many people in this country who, despite the extremely biased pro-government media that portray fascists as Democrats, that there is a fairly wide awareness that terrible things are happening in Ukraine, and that the United States government in particular is sponsoring fascist pogroms and fascist terror. I just wanted to show we talk about the fascist nationalist regime there and about the fascist pogrom in Kiev, which the media here tries to portray as if it was a fight between two groups when it was actually mass murder. My question is, obviously, to us in any case, it is necessary to defend the right of the people of Crimea to determine their fate, to join with Russia, and also for the people of Odessa and the south and east of Ukraine to determine their fate. There are people who are fighting for that, as you said, people who support a Russian empire who are Russian nationalists. My question is, in fighting against the Ukrainian nationalists, ethnic nationalists, and fascists, how is it possible to fight also against the dangers of the Russian nationalism? And is it possible, or it must be possible, to fight in the course of this, to fight for an actual socialist revolution of an internationalist support against all the oligarchs in East and West, as well as in Russia? Thank you.
So I'm going to turn it back to you, Sasha. Your comments.
Okay, so now our comments, and let's start from Ludmila, and then we will move to our friend from Ukraine.
By the way, I just want to say, for people who may have come in late, this is Skype from Moscow, although there are you both people from Ukraine and Russia
here. Быть в составе России, не быть в составе России. Если бы сегодня Татарстан в России, Башкирия в России, люди Башкирии или Татарстана захотели бы отделиться из России, я считаю, мы обязаны считаться с волеизъявлением людей. И нравится нам это или не нравится.
So, Ludmila says that as far as Crimea is concerned, it's important to understand that main reason to be or not to be inside the country is the opinion of citizens of this region. And if in Russia, for example, part of Russian state, Bashkiria or Tatarstan or another part of Russian state will decide to become independent state, Ludmila will say, yes, you can be independent state and this is your view and no problem with that. And if you will, okay, this is the answer. Now about Crimea, everybody about Crimea.
Dear friends and comrades, if to speak about Crimea, now what is the question? For what reason the Crimea so it could quickly say goodbye to Ukraine? Ukraine and Crimea has almost the same relation to each other as, for instance, United States and Cuba. If Cubans, for instance, will say once they don't want to be part of United States, and if United States is weak enough, most likely Cubans will go away. Now, Cubans are there, Crimea is here. Crimeans never wanted to be in Ukraine, surely. Once Ukraine has become weak because of events what happened there, and it was not absolutely Crimeans, participation in all of this. There happened a militant coup. Armored forces could move out the head of the state. Next day, Crimeans jumped and said, maybe this is the moment. And they use it to this moment completely. if in the, for instance, in this moment, there was strong enough Turkey or Bulgaria or Romania, so they could join, to this another state to protect them from possible Ukrainian counter-attack, they could join Turkey or Bulgaria or Romania. But it was near to them, the quite strong Russian Federation, which has the same language and which have their sympathy for a long time, from ever, actually. Because of it, they decided quickly jump and join the Russian Federation. That's all. Consider this. Ukraine relates to Crimea same as USA relates to Cuba. That's all.
Thank you very much, Pavel. And I also tell a few words. Of course, this is not so simple question, mainly because Russia has also double standards, and Russian government, not Russia, but Russian government. And when Russian government discussed question of Crimea, they said, of course, people of Crimea must decide themselves. But after that, it was special law in Russia that no region of Russia can be separated from Russia, and if you will talk in favor of separation of any region of Russia, you are you can be arrested as a criminal. So, by the way, what we are talking now is now criminal behavior according to Russian EU legislation. So this is, of course, double standard. The same for United States, the same for European Union, and so on. When independence is profitable for them, they are in favor of independence. When it's not profitable, they are against. My opinion is the same as the opinion of Ludmila. People of any region can say yes or no to be part of one country or another country, or to be independent from one or another country. With Crimea, there is one problem. Of course, it's not very positive to be part of a Russian capitalist system, and I'm not sure that future of Crimea will be as beautiful as some people in this region are dreaming now. They are dreaming mainly about restoration of Soviet Union and Soviet spirit, because, for example, in Sevastopol, I don't know, maybe majority of population are still has as main values of Soviet Union. It's a very contradictory situation. In reality, they will have Russian oligarchs, and this is, of course, not very positive. But if Crimea will not be part of, if Crimea did not decide to be part of Russia, I'm afraid that next week or next day they can have the same hundreds or thousands of people killed by Ukrainians, by Kiev army and right sector, as it is now in the east of Ukraine. And joining to Russia was the only opportunity not to have war in Crimea. So this is important aspect, and it's necessary to take this aspect into the account. As far as other questions is concerned, very short comment, and maybe my friends also will give these comments. Yes, I think that a big part of these conflicts are a result of the disintegration of the Soviet Union in the form which took place 22 years ago. It was brutal and unjust form of disintegration. And by the way, I am supporter of self-identification, development of states of former Soviet Union, and it was evident, and I was talking about this when Soviet Union existed. But form of this separation was brutal. It was form of brutal capitalism which created negative results for majority of the states, majority of the population of former Soviet Union. So this is true, and disintegration of Soviet Union provoked all these wars, and in our territory we had during the last 20 years many wars, and we had many thousands of people killed because of this. So as far as Odessa is concerned, it's a real tragedy inspired by nationalists and semi-fascists supported by Ukrainian, not Ukrainian really, Kiev government, and it's a real tragedy. And finally, about two nationalism, Russian nationalism and Ukrainian nationalism.
If we are speaking about the general landscape, of course Russia is bigger than Ukraine, and this is sometimes a situation very difficult, and I'm against Russian nationalism. I was against Russian nationalism, and I am against Russian nationalism. But inside Ukraine, Russian-speaking people are a minority. And this is a struggle of minority against absolute domination of majority. For many people in the east of Ukraine, by the way, in Crimea in the past, Russian language was normal native language. And to speak Ukrainian for them is the same like to say to all this audience, you must speak Spanish. If you cannot speak Spanish, nobody will have opportunity to be professor in university. Nobody will have opportunity to participate in state apparatus, nothing. If you are people, you must speak Spanish. If you are not Spanish-speaking people, you are not people at all. Will you agree with this? I am not sure. That's why paradox is that Russian nationalism inside Ukraine became part of the struggle for democracy. This is a very negative situation, but this is reality. And in this case, I was again, and I am against Russian nationalism, but I'm in favor of two languages and rights of all people, Ukrainians and Russian, Ukrainian-speaking people, Russian-speaking people, Tatar-speaking people in Ukraine to have their schools, their universities, and opportunity to be in the parliament. And maybe now, Pavel, your words about all this. Вопрос о том, насколько Советский Союз, распад Советского Союза исключен.
And after this we will have another round of questions.
Carsten, one more comment and then your questions more. Okay? И может ли русский национализм быть средством борьбы с Украиной? If to speak about the Ukrainian situation now as a so to say, consequence of what happened with the Soviet Union, yes, partly it is, but mostly it is a consequence of the world crisis of 2007-2008. This world crisis gave birth to different to economical of decline of Ukraine. From that time, it was actually even before the cadencia or this period of rule of President Yanukovych. It happened then before. It was from 2007. Then Ukrainian President Yushchenko was in power, and then after this Yanukovych came, but crisis grew and grew, and oligarch circles. Had the markets shrinking, markets could become less and less. That's why they start to fight each other. They had to push somebody from the market. And in this fight, in this plain capitalist, what is called competition, they came to the extreme points, then they had to fight with each other by force. There is a children's game, then the children stay around one chair and some music play. Once music ends, somebody have to take chair. Who could not take this chair is out of the game. And this was like this, somebody had to take chair. Somebody had to take this piece of market, which was, so to say, becoming smaller and smaller for Ukrainian economy. This is the plain consequence is the world crisis. But for Soviet Union have ended long ago already, and the time goes very short. Yes, it is to a degree. It is a consequence of dissolvement of Soviet Union. And also a question about
Russian nationalism.
Russian nationalism, you may almost hardly feel you can to find Russian nationalism, you have to go and search. It is in some very small groups which claim themselves Russian monarchists. But those groups are quite small, although they could promote in this wave of resistance against the Kievan neo-Nazis, there is a wave of resistance. In this wave, it is actually quite chaotic. The more or less organized groups like us, like communists, or on the opposite hand, some monarchists, could promote their, for instance, political views better as well they are organized. Because the masses are not organized. Until even now, there is little of organization, there is more of chaos in all of what is going on. Thank you very much.
And a few words of Ludmila and then your questions, I'm sorry.
Okay.
Фашизм Украины нельзя победить ни фашизмом, ни русским фашизмом, ни каким-либо другим. Победа Советского Союза в Великой Отечественной войне была, потому что победил не русский народ, ни татары, ни русские, ни белорусы, ни украинцы, а победили народы Советского Союза. Вот только в этой международной солидарности можно победить фашизм. Но фашизм...
I just asked to give me the opportunity to translate. I said that only together on the basis of internationalism we can fight against nationalism, including Russian nationalism or Ukrainian nationalism. And one of the examples is struggle during Great Patriotic War, World War II, of all people of different nations in our country, in former Soviet Union and other countries against fascism. All together we could win only.
Сегодня фашизм на Украине, бандеровцы поднялись в полный рост, делая вызов, России, Украине, Башкирии, там, я не знаю, Японии, Америке, всем народам мира. Поэтому, если мы не дадим ответ вот этому поднимающемуся фашизму, то он начнет свое наступление. Которая уже затаился этот фашизм и в Европе, и в России, и в Литве, и в других странах мира.
And the most important, said Людмила, Ukrainian fascism and nationalism is part of the world tendency. And now we must fight against Ukrainian fascism, Bandera nationalism and so on, because this is part of the world very negative wave of the growth of right-wing nationalism and semi-fascist groups. And if we will not stop fascist tendencies in Ukraine now, it will be growth of fascist or pro-fascist Nazi tendencies in all over the world, including Europe and other countries. Thank you. And
thank you,
we are sorry for long answers. This is very important for us question.
Okay.
So we raise your question.
Okay, I'm going to get four others. One, two, three, four. Would you please come up? All four will get to speak, and then we'll have another round after that.
Okay.
And let me speak after.
Mm-hmm.
No speeches.
Okay. Would you introduce yourself to Sasha?
Hi, Sasha. Lumila. It's Marilyn Bogdowny. Nice to see you.
Hello.
Marilyn, I'm very happy to see you.
Thank you. I'm very happy to see you. I'm not so happy with your report, however. It sounds to me things are much worse than we were aware of in this country, and I want to ask some questions. First of all, it seems to me obvious that the answer to the problem is there's no independence for Ukraine under capitalism because the IMF has plans to subject it to its policies, and that will end Ukrainian independence, any thought of independence. But what's needed is workers' control over the Ukraine, independent, like Trotsky said, independent workers and peasants, Soviet Ukraine. But what, listening to Yevgeny, he didn't have the vaguest sense of class consciousness. What he wanted to do is help orphans and widows and invalids and stuff. He didn't have any concept of workers' control and any kind of response to all the attacks already on workers' rights. We've been reading about work on the workers being mobilized by the oligarchs into independent militias like Akhmetov did, evidently, of the steel workers, and has them marching around under the command of the oligarch. And I'm wondering, because of the absence of real serious social demands, because it seems like the workers are not even involved, is it true that the workers are just sitting around being used as cannon fodder for whichever oligarch will pay them to come out into the streets?
Okay. And may I ask, comrades, please try to keep it 2 minutes so that the other people can participate as well.
Hello. Thank you for joining us by Skype. My name is Joe Lombardo. I'm also the national co-coordinator of a major anti-war coalition, United National Anti-War Coalition, that has organized demonstrations in 30 cities around the country against U.S. and UE and NATO involvement in the Ukraine, and support very much the activity that you've talked about in the eastern Ukraine and or against the right-wing coup. My main question was one that was just asked. It was about the steel workers. So let me just ask instead, what do you see as the end game? You say it's not a Paris Commune, but where is it going, and what can it lead to, the rebellion in the eastern part of Ukraine? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for keeping it short.
Well, I could just duck out. My name is Barbara Garson, and all I meant to ask was already asked. We all hope for the same kind of a thing, but what do you honestly think will be the outcome of this?
Hi, Sasha and Ludmila.
Hello, greetings.
Greetings from Christina. Do you think that after the U.S. fiasco in Afghanistan and Iraq, the U.S. imperialism is changing from the direct military invasion to national coup d'etats? For example, we have seen this happening from Honduras to Egypt to Ukraine. Thank you.
Hi. Jason Wright for the International Bolshevik Tendency. We, of course, favor the self-determination of Crimeans and their choice of whether to be independent or to affiliate with Russia, and we don't think that Crimea should be bound by something Khrushchev did on one drunken night. But also, I want to ask if there's anything like a formation of defense guards within the Ukraine that consists of, say, Russia phones and Ukrainian speakers and tatters that can resist both the fascist thugs of the right sector, but also guard against any manifestations of great Russian nationalism, and also that the movement, I want to ask what sort of diversity is within it, and freedom of criticism, for instance, to criticize the homophobia and Bonapartism of the Putin regime. Of course, we're all opposed to U.S. and EU imperialism, I hope, and against the right-wing coup government in the Ukraine.
Yes. Yes. Thank you. Hi. My name is David Hungerford. I'm with Freedom Road Socialist Organization / Fight Back. I asked the question earlier about the danger of expanded U.S. direct military involvement. Of course, there are Blackwater mercenaries in there already. How great is the danger that that would occur?
And let me ask the question I asked before, which was, what is happening to the democratic progressive forces that were in some of the initial occupation of Maidan at this point? Okay, we're turning it back to you, Sasha.
Okay, thank you very much, Carter. Okay, who will start? Pavel, maybe you will comment some questions. Ну, вопросы были, какое будущее Украины, главным образом, рабочие.
If to speak about the future of this ongoing conflict in Ukraine, which is, on one hand, oligarchic conflict between different oligarchic groups, but I think we have already passed this phase by. This phase have ended. If there was even for some short period of time a view, so to say, a picture of some of oligarchs supporting the opposition movement of Southeast, now we know they don't. Absolutely. There is no oligarch inside of Ukraine and outside also, that's for sure, who supports the forces of opposition or let's speak fighting forces in the liberated areas of southeast of Ukraine. Because even the biggest oligarch of the East, and he was the strongest and biggest in all of Ukraine, his name is Akhmedov, he is acting absolutely against the eastern, southeastern opposition in everything. And as an answer to it, southeastern opposition have general intention, and it was expressed many times that we want all of this oligarchic property to be confiscated towards the People's Republic needs. Forever. No oligarchs anymore, absolutely. And it is intention of millions now, of masses. That's first. Second, in the phase, in this present phase of the conflict, we have liberated areas which are more or less controlled by the forces which oppose in the Kievan government, and we have Kievan government forces. Now, there is almost chaotic situation from both sides inside of the inside of those groups which present both sides. But this is for long. We are almost sure. It will not end quick, and what is important also to understand, it may be possible to have all three end of it. First end is victory of Kievan government, which will bring this regime to the rest of Ukraine. Second is the victory of anti-Kievan forces, which are mostly anti-fascist, in a coalition with socialists and in coalition with the communists. Of course, such a coalition which can be against the Kievan government. This is second solution. And the third solution is to have some demarcation line like it is in Cyprus, when no force can beat another force. Most likely, this can be also for some time, but in any case, one force have to beat another, or there will be a demarcation line somewhere in between the country. That's all.
Now, Людмила, and I will translate.
Сегодня в Донецкой Республике создаются органы общественного контроля. Это люди, шахтеры, и не только шахтеры, это люди, учителя. Люди из социальной сферы пытаются организоваться, чтобы создавать органы вот этого общественного контроля.
Now in the east of Ukraine there are some new intentions, and people from the below, workers from miners' factories and not only, are creating organs of people's control, and they're trying to control the situation in the region and the economy.
Но без международной поддержки, широкой, активной поддержки, они будут уничтожены вместе с Донецкой Народной Республикой.
And they need to have a real international solidarity, support and international intentions, internationalist intentions. Without such support, they will not have future.
В ельцинский период, когда была криминальная приватизация заводов, я объездила 40 заводов, где рабочие выступили за демократический контроль над этими фабриками и заводами.
It was an interesting similar period in Russia in the end of 90s and beginning of 2000s when in 40 enterprises of Russia there were occupation strikes, and Lyudmila went to all these enterprises from Vyborg to Vladivostok to help people be all together, the time to help people to organize a new form of collective work. But without real solidarity, these intentions unfortunately were defeated. So that's why now we need this international solidarity. Not we, but the Donetsk Republic as well.
И рабочие мне тогда говорили, весь мир западный говорит о значении демократии, но никто не вступился, поддерживая нас. Вот цена словам о демократии.
And the workers of these factories in Russia told that in the West there are a lot of people who are speaking about democracy, but when we are fighting for real democracy in our enterprises, nobody wanted to support us. By the way, from my point of view, I want to add from me that it was support from small left groups, but not from, of course, formally democratic mainstream forces.
Вот почему сегодня очень важно поддержать Донецкую Народную Республику в борьбе с фашизмом, потому что это борьба не только с фашизмом, это борьба за новые социальные альтернативы.
And that's why it's important to support progressive tendencies in the struggle of Donetsk Republic. Progressive tendencies, tendencies of the struggle for social goals, anti-fascist goals, and this will be such support from international community will be very important.
Украинский фашизм нельзя победить русским фашизмом. Это одна и та же сила.
Ukrainian fascism cannot be defeated by Russian fascism. This is only two forms of the same negative force.
Вот почему победа в СССР, Советского Союза Великой Отечественной войны, Великой Отечественной войны, это была победа всех народов СССР.
And Людмила again remind that victory in Second World War, in the Great Patriotic War, was victory of all people again who were from different nationalities. Who were fighting against fascism.
Эта интернациональная победа не случайно символом Донецкой Народной Республики является Георгиевская ленточка, называется. Эта ленточка у нас дома хранится. На ней медаль моего отца, который воевал в Кенигсберге против фашизма. И когда он войну закончил в 17 лет, воюя 2 года до этого.
And in this case it's very symbolic that symbol of Donetsk struggle is special orange-black sign, which was symbol of the heroes, special sign of the heroes in the war against fascism, Second Cold War against fascism. And this international war against fascism became symbol of Donetsk Republic. And this type of sign had the father of Ludmila, who was a soldier fighting fascism in 1945, when he was only 17 years old.
И последнее. Сегодня принципиально важно, чтобы граждане Америки, и левые прежде всего Америки, создали антивоенные какие-то группы, демонстрации, чтобы люди и на Украине, и в России знали о поддержке граждан Америки и видели, что политика Обамы и позиция левых и позиция граждан Америки – это не одно и то же, как это было во время войны в Чечне, когда мы выступали с критикой войны в Чечне, которую вел Ельцин, чтобы видели, что есть граждане России, которые против политики Ельцина, и есть политика Ельцина. Либерализм всегда заканчивается фашизмом.
So I'll try to remember everything. So first of all, it's important that in the United States you will have more and more people who will express your anti-war intentions and solidarity. And we are very glad that you have this because it's extremely important. The same we had when Russia had war in Chechnya, and anti-war solidarity of all groups, including our alternatives, were important, and international support was very important. And this is the only opportunity for us to get victory and to stop the war, escalation of the war in modern situation. Carsten, I have only a few minutes to comment questions, so I will be very brief. And first of all, about question of Marilyn Bogdani. I also do not see very positive solutions of Ukrainian contradictions in the frameworks of oligarch type of capital which had Ukraine and which had Russia. So we are together here, and we are trying to help as much as we can to the progressive tendencies. In this case, the question of Kharkin about progressive forces of Maidan, which took place, which had their struggle half a year ago, what are their future? They have this future, but only now they started to protest against Kyiv government. And as I said today, they went first time to the Maidan, this big square, to say no to Kyiv oligarch government, to say no to oligarch future of Ukraine. Very important aspect, you mentioned Kristina Martinets, who said about United States imperialism and occupation of Iraq, Afghanistan, and now intentions to come to Ukraine. And we are also very afraid that NATO can use military forces and it can be provocation for the new global war, and the provocation from NATO could lead to the real terrible conflict from all mankind. So let's do all together all possible and impossible to prevent this aggression from NATO, and we will do the same to prevent aggression from Russia. As far as modern Russia is concerned, we have anti-oligarchic, anti-bureaucratic forces, we have critique of Putin regime, but now it's one of the paradoxes. Putin became symbol of the anti-imperialist struggle and symbol of the any form of struggle against NATO. And in this situation, we have much more contradictions and difficulties in this struggle and in this action, but we are trying to do our best. And about future, again, for us, the best solution will be a real united Ukraine with a federal, maybe, confederation inside, with two languages or three languages as state languages, as real, with real democracy and social orientation of development of economy, and so on. And for this, we must fight now, but in the situation of military conflict, I think we have to support, first of all, struggle of Donetsk people for their rights against mass killing. And we must condemn the Ukrainian army, right sector, and other professors' forces for killing people, and condemn the Kyiv government for this. Now, I think they are, first of all, responsible for the conflict. They must say, okay, if you want to be independent, you must be independent. We will recognize this, no war. Let's have what we have. That will be the end. And then you will see. In Ukraine, in the center and the west of Ukraine, the life is fantastic. The life in your republic is terrible, so you will decide to join to Ukraine like Crimea people decided to join to Russia. So let's do the same. Let's invite people to be part of our country, not because we force them to do this, but because life in our country is better than in other countries. Only this situation can be unification. Okay. Unification. So this is my opinion. And at the end, I want to say thank you very much, comrades, colleagues, friends. First of all, thank you very much to Carsten Sproul, to Olga, to everybody who organizes this. This is from all of us, our greetings and our thanks. And for the future, you can use our website, alternative.ru, by at the end. There are a lot of video and other information, facts about real public. And you can write directly me. It's very simple. Busgalin@mail.ru. Carsten can give you this email. And we are very glad to be in solidarity, and we will help you to contact Donetsk people, Kyiv people, Western Ukrainian people. And now maybe Carsten will tell a few words. Thank you.
I just wanted to thank Sasha very much. And also, I hope that next year, whatever is happening there, we can get Sasha to come again to the Left Forum and speak directly. Thank you, Sasha. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
If I had a hammer, I'd hammer in the morning. I'd hammer in the evening. All over this land. I'd hammer out danger. I'd bring it in the morning, I'd bring it in the evening. Oh, listen.